Hello everyone, I'm Naya Swami Asha, and we are at number 10 of Swami Kriyananda's 26 Keys to Higher Awareness. Number 10 says, say yes to life. And then he goes on to say, number 10 is, say yes to life with an exclamation point. Number 10 is, say yes to life with an exclamation point. It's very simple. The first album of music that Swami put out was an album that said, say yes to life. It's been a mantra, so to speak, of the self-realization path as followed by Ananda for a very long time. So did I say number 10 is say yes to life with an exclamation point? And then Swami goes on to talk about it in a very interesting way. He says, in everyone, two voices compete. The one is life affirming, the other life negating. Be open to the yes-saying influence. When faced with any new opportunity, ask yourself, how can I make it a reality? Shun the tendency of so many people to enumerate all the reasons why a new idea could not possibly work. And I was going back to our very beginning when I was reading the introduction Swami made to these 26 keys, and he says, a study of the lives of successful men and women suggests there are two characteristics common to all of them. And number one is an abundance of energy. So saying yes to life with an exclamation point, which incidentally is number 10 on the list, is really about how to have an abundance of energy. And it's, you know, there's so many things on the spiritual path, especially the way Swami Kriyananda has offered it to us, and Master also, that are deceptively simple. And the mind wants something more complex, and the intellect wants many more complicated things to mull over. I was recently in Israel on a pilgrimage to the places holy to the life of Jesus, but in the course of that, we also dealt with the Old Testament and with Judaism to a certain extent. It wasn't central to the pilgrimage, but nonetheless, it was a very interesting part of it. And one of the people we met there was a man in the country who's a foremost scholar of the Kabbalah. Kabbalah is the mystical side of Judaism. It's ancient. And in fact, he lived in a town, Zafed. I always can never remember how to say it. Zafed? Zafed? It's spelled many different ways. And in the 1600s, a very wise rabbi established that place as a center of the study of mystical Judaism. And here's now an American-born, now Israeli, scholar of the Kabbalah who is also an artist. And he was a deep man, and his commitment to that teaching was very deep and very impressive. It's always impressive to see people with an abundance of energy and a determination in what they're following. No matter what they're following, there's a sense of kindred spirit among other people who are also deeply dedicated to what they're doing. But the Kabbalah is a complicated text. And this man was brilliant and has made a lifelong study of many of the complicated interrelated features of that text and the relationship between Hebrew and Hebrew letters and Hebrew sounds and various other mystical realities. It was much more than I could comprehend. And I was so grateful that it wasn't my path. I don't mean to be rude about that, but let me just be realistic about it. There are many, many, many paths to the same goal. All roads lead to the top of the mountain. All true spiritual paths transcend their differences and converge at the top of the mountain. You can come up to it from many sides, and if you have a mountain peak, every different path will take you through different scenery, different terrain, require different equipment. Some can be done solo, some require a whole expedition. There's all different ways to all reach the same goal, to transcend ego, to become utterly compassionate, and we find our own way. And I've had many. I came to this path of Swamiji and Master at a very young age. I never wavered in my commitment to it ever. Thank you, God. And I've always been grateful, and it suits me to a T, is the only way I can think about it. So even though, like when I met this man, I was extremely impressed, both with the teaching he follows and the energy and intelligence and dedication with which he follows it, but also a little piece of me was so happy that I have another way. You know, that I don't have to study at great depth these complicated interrelationships. I have teachings like, say yes to life with an exclamation point. And the challenge of each one of us following the way that belongs to us is to bring to bear, you know, all of our energy and all of our commitment, and to listen to what we're being said and discern among the many choices that are in front of us those things which will particularly serve us. And I have a very complicated mind myself, just, you know, to be very frank about it. I'm not by nature a simple person. I strive to be simpler, and by the grace of God, as Swamiji said to me once when I backed him into a corner and forced him to give me a compliment. Swamiji was not one to lavish praise upon people. He was very supportive in the ways that really mattered, and he was also extremely truthful, and he saw no point in bolstering your ego. He was there to support your soul. He wasn't there to crush your ego, but he was very judicious in his use of praise, and you could always rely upon him to speak the truth. Whatever he said to you, you knew it was exactly what he meant. I used to do a lot of writing in those years for promotional things, and Swamiji would often always, for a long time, always review what I wrote. And his responses were always exact. This is okay. We can use it. This is good. Asha, this is excellent. You know, and I always knew exactly, it was exactly right, and objectively speaking, he was always exactly accurate. So in this particular case, I don't know what the context was, but he was saying things about various people, and I was present and made myself so noticed that it would have been rude of him not to say something. So he said to me, Asha, you're a lot less confused than you used to be. Which, actually, I was honest enough to think, in fact, I am. I'm a lot less confused than I used to be. In other words, some of that completely unnecessary spinning like a top in circles, you know, going every direction, getting nowhere, which had characterized my life, and still did to a certain extent, but I was a lot less confused than I had been before. And over the course of years, I believe I'm even less confused now. And a certain amount of that is really accepting that some of the simplest teachings are really the most important, and we don't really need to make it more complicated. Now, one of the things that helps me to come into that understanding is a distinction that I figured out, that for something to be simple is not the same as saying that it's easy to do. Because some of the simplest things, for example, love God, you know, it's very simple to say that, but it's not always easy to do that when you're confronted with profound loss, when circumstances force you to see yourself in a light that you are embarrassed or overwhelmed at having to consider. I mean, these things are not easy, but that doesn't mean they're complicated. I remember once I had a difficult karma with a certain soul, and circumstances allowed us to live without much interaction eventually. And the farther distance I got from the personality of my Guru Bhai, the more I was able to appreciate her noble qualities. And gradually I almost forgot the personality conflicts we'd had, and all I could think about was her noble qualities. So when the opportunity came for us actually to travel together and even to share accommodations, I naively agreed. and thought that because my distant relationship with her felt so harmonious in my heart, I thought my up-close relationship would be too. It took me about 30 minutes to realize that I was far from done. And I was so sad about it. I really thought that I'd freed myself from a difficult karma, and instead I realized I had just had an intermission. I hadn't really transcended. I had just been spared for a period of time, and I was weeping as I was telling this to Swamiji. And he looked at me, and his viewpoint about everything was so different. Let me phrase it differently. He was so courageous. And he never wanted to waste time on... It wasn't that he was unfeeling. That would be very wrong to say. He had a very tender heart, and he was very compassionate, and he had profound understanding of human suffering. He wasn't in any way cavalier. You know, if it brought you to tears, he understood. I understand why you feel that way, was this wonderful phrase he would use. I understand why you feel that way, and he really did, no matter what it was. It wouldn't be necessarily that he thought it was helpful even for you to feel that way, but he did understand why you feel that way. So there I am weeping about this realization of difficulty, and Swami just says, well, he said, you thought you had gotten over it, and therefore you weren't putting out any energy to get over this fault. He said, and now you find out that you need to put out more energy. He said, that's actually good news, because otherwise you were going on a false assumption. Oh, I said, not at all how I felt about it. Oh, well, that is one way to look at it, isn't it? So we make things, and let me just think, I had a clear connection with what I was saying. Let me see if I can find it again. Oh, yes, the difference between complicated and easy. Sometimes, in fact, we prefer to make things complicated, because if they're complicated and we have to think about it, then often we don't have to do anything about it, and it spares us the necessary effort. It spares us the sometimes ego-crushing realization that we're not as good as we hoped we were. It makes us realize that maybe this is not my last incarnation, but that I have a little more karma to work out, all these different things we don't want to know. And so if we make it complicated, we can keep going in circles and not really have to face in. So Swamiji often reduces the path to really simple points, like say yes to life. And what he's describing here, he says, everybody has two voices within them. And this is, again, another one of those extremely simple but very important concepts to keep in mind. Every single scripture, every single religious epic, especially every single religious epic, every single noble story, but especially every epic, is a war. You know, the Battle of Kurukshetra, the Gita comes out of that, the whole Mahabharata, the Ramayana, Homer's Iliad, the whole New Testament. Old Testament, I mean. He said the Old Testament is just one war after another. As I said, I was recently in Israel, and our guide was a scholar of the Old Testament, and I heard a lot about those battles, this king and that king and everything that happened. When I read the Old Testament through, which I did on one occasion, I don't know that I read every word, but I spent quite some time and I read a lot of it. I read the version called the New Jerusalem Bible, which for me really made the Bible accessible to me, because the New Jerusalem Bible, even though it's not the most beautiful, not the most poetic, and in some cases not even the most accurate, I found it the most readable. So I read much through the Old Testament, and it was a little bit of my feeling about the Kabbalah, which is I'm glad I have a simpler route. I'm sure that there was much in there that's exquisite, but so much of it is this one fighting that one, and that one fighting this one, and then this one fighting that one, and then that one fighting this one, and then God smiting various ones who are fighting each other, and huff, puff, I was glad I didn't have to rely solely on that to understand the spiritual path. But there was an awful lot of conflict. And it wasn't just the conflict of the Jewish people against hereditary enemies or anything like that. It's just that there's a lot of conflict in spiritual life, and it's annoying because it's not how we want to think about it. We want to think about it as God's love. We want to think about it as Satchitananda, ever-existing, ever-conscious, ever-new bliss. We want to think of it as a tiny bubble of laughter. I have become the sea of mirth itself. We have all these absolutely gorgeous images, and they're all true, of the perfect freedom that awaits us. But we also have all these images of the fight. And that's because that's what it feels like. Even though, in the end, in truth, from the actual perspective of God's view of it, we are all children of God, we are all children of light, and there is only one reality, and that one reality is bliss. But we also have to recognize that that bliss is not handed to us effortlessly, and that there is nothing wrong with us if we find ourselves constantly engaged in this struggle. I had a conversation with someone not too long ago, and that individual was trying to use an affirmation that was, you know, everything is love, light, and joy, and everything else is nonsense. Well, that's true. You know, from the divine perspective, everything else doesn't make any sense at all. It's nonsense. But that's an affirmation that we have to earn, in a certain sense, the right to use for it to actually be efficacious for us. And some people can use that because their perception is so strong and their ability to master their own consciousness is so well developed that they can look the enemy in the eye and just laugh. And it's as simple as that. One man in our community, his name is Ananta, has a lot of that characteristic. And when the Sacramento Ananda community was first forming, Ananta was the leader then, and the community, the Ananda group, had purchased an apartment complex, which was occupied by other people, which they were converting gradually into an Ananda community, which meant that many of the people who were resident there now would have to find other places to live because they weren't going to be able to transition into the Ananda community. It wasn't for them. And the community was a little bit of a fixer-upper, and so some of the residents were less noble than they might have been. And some of them were the kind of people who tended to see everyone else as out to get them, and themselves as victims, innocent victims of everything that happened. So the prospect of a Ananda community coming in and them not being able to continue to live there, even though almost all of them had only been there a short time anyway, caused some of them to react. And one man actually came to Ananta, who was in charge, with a gun, and pointed a gun at him and told him, how mad he was about this whole thing. And Ananta, absolutely fearlessly, because he was such a master of his own consciousness, just stepped forward and said, "Go ahead and shoot me. But even if you shoot me, you're still going to have to move out." what power, you know? What is there to fear in life? All of that is just nothing. However, for others of us, and I put myself in that category, my delusions are not so easy to dismiss because they have insinuated themselves into my consciousness in ways that I'm not so aware of. I'm not sure who is what, is another way to put it. And this is how I've thought about it, which is, I've spent a lot of lifetimes getting this confused, to use Swami's words for me. I've spent a lot of lifetimes making wrong choices, misperceiving them as right choices, misjudging my reality, building another reality on top of what I misjudged. A perfect example, I'm at a distance from this person whose personality doesn't bring the best out of my personality. And I just imagine that I can just control myself and see something different. It's just fantasy on my part. And what that experience taught me is that, and how else can I put it, except to say I have to have more respect for my delusions. I spent a long time building them up, and they're not going to just go away from my just snapping my finger and saying, oh, I'm done with you. I may want to be done with you, but I have to respect them in this sense, which is, if you're going to go into the boxing ring with someone who's a world-class boxer, you can't just go in saying, well, you know, everything is love and light, and everything else is nonsense, and expect to win. You have to train. You have to compete against people who are more the right size for you. You have to develop your courage and your technique. And then, yes, sooner or later, you can meet the world-class opponent on the world-class level. But it is not because you've just said, oh, any other thing is silly. It's that you've said, I'm not there yet. I have to keep working on this. So in the course of working our way out of these delusions, it's exactly as Swami says here. All of us have two voices within us. And one of those voices is life-affirming, and as he put it, one of them is life-negating. And that's a very interesting way to put it. I'll put it in other words that I find the picture of these words is the most helpful. And it is the concept of whether you're being expansive or whether you're being contractive. Now, if you can think about the entire spiritual life as these two forces, and I'll use the words your self-identification, because the spiritual path is to gradually expand our self-definition and our self-identification to the point where it becomes infinite. The fact of the matter is, we don't suddenly become infinite. There is never a point in all of creation when we aren't already fully one with God. But we exist on many levels at the same time. And even a God-realized master, you know, still has to eat to feed his body, or food has to be given to him, or he has to nourish his body in some way. He still has a physical body. Generally speaking, that physical body is subject to physical laws. Sometimes the masters stand outside of these things. But he exists on many levels at the same time. When Yogananda's disciple, Sister Gyanamata, died, Master said he saw her, Gyanamata, he saw her merge into the infinite. She was completely free. Now, as her guru, this was the goal of who knows how many incarnations of shared effort, was to bring her to the point where she could merge with infinity. It was the culmination of everything. And yet at the same time, Sister Gyanamata, as that particular incarnation, as a companion to Yogananda in his incarnation as Yogananda, as the life they were living together and the work they were doing together on behalf of seeking souls everywhere. In other words, that beautiful incarnation, when she left that body and transcended this world, it was over. And Yogananda felt it keenly and actually wept for the loss of her beautiful company at the same time that he rejoiced. How could he not? To see her freed forever and merging into the infinite. So a master exists on all levels, but he identifies himself with infinity. So even as he, you might say, reached down and experienced the natural propensity of the human heart and didn't resist that flow of energy through him, but at the same time he was able to keep his awareness of infinity. Now, our problem is a very simple one, which is when we're experiencing the natural propensities of the human heart and the many emotional and egoic imperatives that have accumulated in the vrittis in our chakras from all the choices we've made, all the habits we've affirmed, all the self-definitions that we've built up, we may have a theoretical or a philosophical idea that my true nature is infinity, but we actually identify with the limited. And therefore the limited in that moment completely defines us. And all our decisions are made on the basis of it. We may be influenced by the awareness of our own potential, but we're not able to be defined by it. And so what we're doing is we're constantly trying to expand our self-definition and to expand our self-identity. I mean, you can think of it in a very practical way. Well, as your body ages, for example, if you're deeply identified, as women often are, with the beauty, of the youthful beauty of the feminine person, and the inevitable happens, and you lose that youthful beauty, you may become a handsome older woman, but that unique prettiness of female youth, it's just gone. I remember a friend of mine, she basically said, I'm not going to be young, slim, and beautiful in this body ever again. It's just how she put it. She said, I'm going to have to get a new one before I'm there again. And she accepted it. But imagine those who are deeply defined by that, and you lose it. What if you're deeply defined by being a mother, and your children leave home and go away, and for karmic reasons, you have even little contact with them anymore, and they don't give you any grandchildren, and insofar as you have defined and identified yourself as a mother and don't find another less personal way to express it by taking care of others' children, for example, or becoming a teacher or a foster parent or any of those things, you'll be stuck because your self-definition was too contractive. If you can expand your self-definition, as I was saying, even as an example, as a mother, by beginning to mother children that you didn't give birth to, and now you can still be a mother, but you have an expanded definition of what it means. Or if you realize in yourself that what your joy in being a mother was really being able to be a channel for the loving qualities of Divine Mother, and you realize that you can be a channel for Divine Mother, whether you have any children to nurture or not, now you've expanded your self-definition. And so what we keep doing as we grow on the spiritual path by going through many different circumstances and learning to be always conscious of the divine within, no matter what those circumstances, what we're doing is we're expanding our self-definition, our self-identification, our very concept of where happiness comes from and whether or not circumstances can ever take that happiness away from us. And to be contractive is to go in just exactly the opposite direction. I've lost certain things, therefore I am now diminished, especially in terms of suffering and happiness. You know, now I have lost and I must suffer. Instead of saying, now I have lost and I must expand into a self-definition that can go beyond whatever it is that I think I've lost. And every time we have an experience, the two voices within us, Swami calls it life-affirming or life-negating, are asking us, will I expand to embrace this new reality, or will I contract and try to hold on to what I have and hold that reality at bay? Swami puts it in this number 10 by saying, when faced with any new opportunity, ask yourself, how can I make it a reality? It's a very interesting way to put it. He's talking about opportunities for success, a new possibility, but in a sense, every minute of your life is a new opportunity. And will I affirm my expansive potential by accepting this and incorporating it into my reality and going forward? Now, that doesn't mean we're passive in the face of the things that happen. But the first step toward overcoming anything is to realize that it's there. As Swamiji put it, in the name of positive thinking, to invade a foreign country with only 10 soldiers and hope that the army is on holiday, I mean, that's just foolish. That's not looking at what reality is. You have to be able to see things as they really are. And sometimes in the name of positive thinking, people just refuse to accept what's true. I know many years ago now, a decade or more ago, when America had to face the experience of 9/11, and there was the attack on the World Trade Centers in New York, and you know, it was a very traumatic experience for America because it was really the largest attack on American soil since the Civil War. I believe that's the case. And the largest number of casualties and so on. And it was very traumatic. Every country has its karma, and that was our karma to go through. And a lot of spiritually minded people wanted to affirm that we should just love the people who had attacked us. Now that sounds good and is true on a certain level. But Swamiji was very quick to also point out that there is, in this world, misguided action. That people will think that some action on their part will bring a desirable result, but in fact they're misguided. A war in all respects is misguided, no matter which side you're on. Sometimes you are attacked, and your cause is righteous, and you have to fight back. World War II had many very clear examples of that the culture of Nazism that was trying to take over so much of the world was simply not something that noble-minded people could allow to happen. And it was a righteous war for a cause that had to be fought. Now, please, I know there's many dimensions to things, but there is also that aspect of it. And Swami wanted us to understand that sometimes just to sort of affirm the positive is not actually being expansive. It's actually not having the courage to just look right at a very unpleasant truth. And part of becoming a mature person at this stage on this planet is to realize that there are many very unpleasant truths, and not everything can be so readily resolved into a happy ending. Whether that's an acknowledgement of the intractability of one's own limitations, or the fact that this is early Dwapara Yuga and we are sharing the planet with many people whose self-definitions are so contractive that they simply do not allow the continuation of other people's self-definitions. They can't live with both. They feel strongly that one has to be eliminated. This leads to religious bigotry and zealous nationalism and violence and terrorism of all kinds. I recall, this was a very small situation, but I was a guest on a radio program once many years ago, and I was representing Ananda community at that time, and that was Ananda Village. That was the only Ananda community there was. And I had been invited onto the program to talk about the community, about our way of life, about organic gardening, about, you know, dairy farming, about lots of very concrete realities. I wasn't invited to talk about spirituality. In the pre-program conversation, I got to know the fact that my host was dedicated to a very fundamentalist concept of Christianity, and that prior to being saved by our Lord Jesus Christ, as he put it, he'd been a drug addict. And so I knew that his faith was expansive for him, that as narrow as his faith might look to me, as contractive as it would be for me from where I was standing to accept that there was only one way and it had to be that way, from his point of view it was expansive, because now he saw himself as loved by God. And now he saw himself as having hope and having a future and having a purpose, and the suicidal self-abnegation that had led him to become a drug addict had been overcome. So he was really expanding. But at a certain point in the program, somehow or another, he was looking at the materials we gave him or something like that, and he realized that my spiritual path was quite different than his, and part of the obligation upon him on his path was that he had to bear witness to the truth of his path over all others. So in the middle of the radio program, he started trying to convert me to our Lord Jesus Christ as my only Savior. It was a bit awkward for me because I had no wish whatsoever to hurt his faith, but nor was I going to engage in such a conversation at that point. And I told him quite simply that my definition of spirituality was broad enough to include his was not broad enough to include mine, but I was simply not going to discuss it with him. And I went into silence, and I refused to answer any of his questions or participate in the interview until he dropped the subject and went back, which of course he had to do because we were on live radio at the time. So one of the things we have to recognize is, you know, no amount of my being nice or being reasonable or being broad-minded with that man was going to have a whit of effect on him. He was standing where he needed to be, and he was strong in it. And for that moment, that was where he needed to be. And there are many people in the world who are not able to see beyond where they're standing. Will it bring them happiness? Not necessarily, but it's the lesson they have to learn, and they're not going to be talked out of it just because we're nice. And that's a hard lesson. And that's part of what Swami's saying here when he's talking about there's always two voices. There's two voices on the planet. There really is a life-negating force. And we have to come to terms with that life-negating force and meet it. And that's what Swami, when he was talking to me about my naivete in relation to this woman who I really had not transcended my conflict with her, you didn't know it was there, and therefore you weren't putting out any energy to overcome it. You thought you had won, and you hadn't won at all. You hadn't even begun to really transcend this. And so with us, we have to recognize that unless we put out dynamic energy to constantly be affirming our expansive commitment to a positive, God-centered definition of ourselves, we can't just coast. We can't just think that, well, anything I think is going to be right because, after all, I love God. No, we have to pay very close attention. And this training ourselves to be expansive in our response, to have faith that we can face and overcome it, and to recognize the reality of what we're actually dealing with. Every opportunity, and I know Swami meant it slightly different than this, opportunity to accomplish something, be positive about it. See how you can make it work. And he says, don't be one of those people who's always listing why it can't work. I know Swamiji once said to me, and it was rather a surprise to me, we were talking about dynamic positive energy. And I was raising some questions about a certain way he affirmed positive energy when it seemed to me that the situation didn't warrant it. And he said to me, he said, Asha, sometimes you're negative. And I don't think of myself as negative. I'm usually quite a yes, we can do it sort of person, I thought. But Swami said, yes, yeah, sometimes you're negative because, he put it like this, you're so factual. And what he meant by that is somehow I feel an obligation to make sure everybody's aware of all the obstacles we might meet. But what does that do to the yes-saying principle? And yes, those obstacles have to be met, and yes, energy has to be put out. But in the moment, when a new idea is presented, what good is it to say all the reasons why this new idea won't work? All that does is think about it in terms of people of higher awareness who are very successful in life are always people who have a great deal of energy. What happens when we have an exciting new idea and the first thing that happens is, oh, but there's this problem and that problem and this problem and that problem and this problem and that problem? Yes, those are reality, and they may have to be dealt with, but what kind of energy do we have when we think like that? You know, the mere fact of saying, yes, we can do it, in and of itself helps us attract solutions. Being solution conscious, which has also been one of our principles, you know, coming up into this, to just say, yes, we'll deal with this. Yes, we can face it. And even saying yes helps you to be more realistic about it because you're thinking expansively. So often, we think that problems are there because we just haven't thought expansively enough. Swami Kriyananda was just masterful at just figuring out solutions. And he always had this deep faith, this very, very deep-seated sense of the positive outcome. Now, part of his sense of the positive outcome was that everything will resolve in a positive way. And he didn't always mean that the short-term situation would turn out to be exactly what we wanted, but he knew that if we always continually see all circumstances from a yes, I will face this, yes, this is an opportunity, yes, I'm going to go into this and be as creative as possible in listening to the expansive side of my nature and not allow myself to just give up before I've even started. You know, there's a certain quality of successful people, which is just simply that. This needs to be done, so I'll figure out a way to do it. And often just that, I will figure out a way to do it, is in itself what brings the opportunities to us. We have that open-minded capacity even to think a little bit outside the box, is another way to put it. Swami Kriyananda, in teaching us how to manifest, he often has spoken like that. When, for example, many years ago, when we were trying to think how to have a community here in the Palo Alto area, and we've been now living in this community for many years, we're still leasing it. We don't own it, although we're about to launch a very serious campaign to shift from being renters to being owners, but that's a whole different project. But when we were first trying to establish ourselves in a practical way, we asked Swamiji how we should pray about this, and his answer was very interesting. He said, you don't have to continually ask God if this is a good thing. He said, self-evidently it's a good thing. You're very sincere in your motive. Your intention for living together is a God-centered intention. You don't have to keep feeling insecure about whether what you're aspiring to do, you know, has the approval of God. You can feel his approval. So what you really have to keep praying for is, show me my next step. What should I do next? You know, guide us in everything that we do, but hold always that thought that God will guide you and that there is a next step and that we can keep moving forward toward this. And if it turns out to be different, he will show you in good time. And if we're always asking, show me what comes next, that very response just frees up our energy. You know, the negativity itself just kind of drains energy out of it. I mean, think about it. When you look at situations, when you're with people, just think about when you're with people. I remember a friend of mine, I just became so impatient with him because everything that happened, he would always find a reason with just this tone of voice. Well, like that. You know, and everybody's feeling really cheerful and then, well, and then what happens to your energy and your enthusiasm and your desire to go forward? Swami Kriyananda once, we had a brainstorming session once many years ago, and the subject was building a temple at Ananda Village. And we just started talking about what that temple might look like. And we got so inspired by the ideas we had, and they got more and more, well, expansive. You might even say more and more impractical. But they also just got more and more expansive. What would be really beautiful? You know, what would really inspire us? What would really create a magnetic, energetic, holy environment? And we started talking about crystals, and we even started talking about gemstones, and we talked about design elements that we could put in. And it was such a beautiful meeting, and it was like we were on the astral world, where we knew we could just visualize it and materialize it, and there were no obstacles to the beauty that our own hearts could imagine. And interestingly, for a long time afterwards, actually for years afterward, Swami referred to that particular meeting as one of the best meetings we'd ever had at Ananda. Now, with my rather factual orientation, which somehow I'd managed to put aside in that moment, I was also thinking, you know, well, but can we really do it? But what Swami was talking about is that we'd finally disconnected our sense of what was possible, what we could imagine that would be, what was beautiful, from all the facts about what might prevent us from doing it. And so often through the years, Swamiji would try to get us to, well, say yes to the possibilities even of our own nature. You know, Swami Kriyananda, at the age of 36, after having been a monk in Self-Realization Fellowship for 14 years, and that was a more traditional monastic order. He lived in a monastic setting with other monks. He lived in an ashram. He did not get a personal salary. He had no personal possessions. He lived, the monastery supported him. He had a small monthly allowance. Just in every way, even though it was a Self-Realization Fellowship ashram, it was set up along traditional monastic lines. He'd entered the monastery when he was 22. It was a complete break with everything that had come before, and in those 14 years, the only life he had was serving Yogananda, associating with other devotees and disciples or people who were interested in the master's teachings, even though he had traveled a great deal around the world for SRF and was living at that time in India on their behalf. Nonetheless, the entire context of his life was the monastery and the organization he served. And for various reasons, he tells the story in A Place Called Ananda and other books. He was expelled. He was 36. It was 1962. He was expelled. He was forbidden to ever go back to any SRF property. He was forbidden to contact any SRF member. They even tried to persuade him never to tell anyone he was even a disciple of Yogananda, a prohibition he found impossible to follow. But he did separate himself completely from SRF at that point, and that meant everybody he knew, every friend he had in the world. He was completely alone. And as it happened, he moved back in with his parents. He lived in their spare bedroom. He had no money because he was a fully professed monk. He had no money of his own, a few hundred dollars, nothing more than that. No possessions, nothing. From that back bedroom in his parents' house, he created all of Ananda. He wrote eventually 400 pieces of music, I don't know what, 150 books, whatever it turned out to be. Just phenomenal. Tens of thousands of people, 9 communities around the world, it goes on and on. And he started with nothing. I mean, nothing. His parents had money, but they never gave it to him. His father didn't believe in what he was doing, and he didn't support it. Swami generated all of it by saying yes to life. I mean, that's a very important aspect. He felt inwardly that this is what Master wanted him to do, and he took time to really feel inwardly that this was what Master wanted him to do. He understood himself as a disciple, and even though the organization his guru founded and his guru buys tried to take that away from him, he never allowed them to. He held it always in his heart as his own. He belonged to Master, and Master belonged to him, and no one could interfere with that. And he felt called and commissioned by Master to do a work for Master, to serve him. And so Swamiji just started out. He just started out step by step. And the yes he was always saying was, yes, Master, I will serve you. And if you close one door, I will just find another. And I will walk as far as I can down whatever path that leads to. And if it ends in a dead end, I will just move around it and find another spot. He never allowed himself to give in to that contrary voice. And that contrary voice was there. In him, the contrary voice was personified by the unrelenting disapproval of his gurubhais, who were constantly trying to undermine his confidence in his relationship to his own guru. But Swami always said, I am a disciple. He said yes to that fundamental truth. I am a disciple. And as a disciple, I must serve my guru. And everything that Swami did just came from that premise. And when the two voices would compete in his head, wherever they would come from, he would always just go back to his first premise. I am a disciple, and I will serve my guru. You know, in my own life, I've made the foundation affirmative concept that I work with at all times is this one. You know, I deeply believe in the spiritual path. I believe that I am on the path that belongs to me. This is the bedrock of my life. Everybody has a bedrock point, and you should find it, and you should know very clearly what that bedrock point is. For me, I have faith. I have experience the truth of the spiritual path. I believe in karma. I believe that everything that happens is fair. I believe that God is behind everything that happens to me, and whatever I may think about it, however little or much I may enjoy it, it's all given to me for my ultimate freedom. And more deeply, the yes that I say is, there is no alternative. Swamiji once was asked, you know, what are the essential attitudes for success on the spiritual path? And one of them, he said quite simply, was, you must understand that it's a matter of life or death. In other words, there's no alternative. I face it now or I face it now. And if that now comes 100 lifetimes from now, it's still going to be now when it comes. Why postpone it? And so the yes always is, this comes from God and I will face it. And that's the yes that we really have to have on the deepest possible level. You know, who am I? Why was I born? And how can I persevere in that no matter what? No matter how unhappy I am, no matter how much I waver, no matter how bad this month, year, or decade is, the yes you have to say is, I will persevere because my success is guaranteed as long as I don't give up. Now, we have a question. And what is that question?
How do you fight back without hate?
Hate. How do you fight back without hate? Well, it's very simple, really. But this is the contrary voice within you. This is what I come back to. These delusions are not easily overcome. There's no way. There's no secret. I've had so many people ask me questions. Thousands of questions. Probably only hundreds, maybe even only dozens. But many questions that have very complicated forms and come from many different angles. But the central question is always the same. Isn't there a shortcut? Isn't there an easier way to do it? How do you fight back without hate? You fall into the trap of negative emotion, whether it's hate or anger or whatever it might be. You experience that no one is more injured by your negative emotion than yourself. You suffer the consequences of that negative emotion. And then you resolve to try again. And experience is what teaches you. And yes, there is this limited identification that imagines that something good will come to me if I can just strike back. And hate is just a way of striking back. Swamiji said something very interesting. It's interesting that this question should be asked because I've been thinking about this very thing recently. Swamiji said something most interesting, and he put it like this. You know, when you project a negative thought towards someone, its origin point is you. The biggest power starts with you, because whatever power you project has to be the power that you have inside of you. And whatever you're able to direct towards someone else, only some of what you have inside of you reaches them, because it diminishes over space, and even if you're powerful, the energy is the strongest at its source, and its source is you. And therefore, the vibrations of that negative emotion are going to have the most effect on you, because in the moment that you are projecting hate towards someone, or projecting anger, or resentment, or whatever you might be projecting, you are that vibration. So you are permeated with that vibration. Otherwise, you wouldn't be able to project it. So whatever vibrations of negativity in whatever form that other person receives you yourself receive more. And so what happens to us is that if we continually act as a channel for those vibrations, then our world becomes those vibrations. And not only do we live in them all the time, but like attracts like. And I've been aware recently, and this is just the karmic law, whenever you experience negativity either seemingly spontaneously within yourself, which may be self-hatred or despair or self-criticism that paralyzes your creativity, it's an exact proportion to which you sent it out. Whatever you've sent out, it just defines you, and then you get to experience it again. And how you gradually learn to overcome these is you just realize it's not worth it, that you're not hurting anybody but yourself. And if you keep stabbing yourself in the head with a knife and you finally figure out that the pain in your head is because of the knife in your hand, then it's not hard to take it out. That's not exactly the perfect answer necessarily, but that is certainly something to think about. Do we have another question?
Whatever you just said to this person feels contradictory to the idea of not sending love to the people who are attacking.
I didn't say you didn't send love to them, but you have to also, question is, they thought what I was saying was contradictory to what I said about not sending love to people who are attacking us. This is how Swami put it. We have to be mature enough to realize that some people's determination to be dark is greater than our power to lift that darkness from them. And sometimes you have to acknowledge that this is a dark force, and that dark force has to be dealt with on terms that can actually contain it. And so merely to say, oh, we ought to love everyone, which is generally how people say that, oh, we ought to love everyone, and imagine that that dark force won't then just gallop over and destroy you, is naive. I mean, Master himself, with his profound admiration for Gandhi, said that the reason Gandhi was able to liberate India nonviolently was because, as he put it, and Master was not necessarily a great fan of the British character, but he said that the English people are essentially gentlemen, that they would not engage in an unfair fight, is how he put it. So when Gandhi presented before them an unfair fight, their national character responded in such a way that they had to bow to his superior force at that point. Gandhi maturely gauged his enemy. And there are many national groups against which that strategy would have served nothing. They would have just been slaughtered, and that would have been the end of it. And so it wouldn't have been a realistic strategy. And so what Swamiji was responding to was that most of the impetus, and I'm not going to speak of all of it, but most of the impetus for, oh, we ought to just love them, was not reality. We're not going to, if people are that determined, and, you know, not talking specifically even about that situation, if people are that determined to be an instrument of darkness, you have to match their energy. And if you really, like as Yogananda said, you know, you can practice, you can practice ahimsa in front of a tiger, and if you have enough power, as he himself did, you can tame the tiger. But if you don't have as much power to tame the tiger as the tiger has hunger to eat you, he said, you'll be practicing nonviolence in the tiger's tummy. That's how he put it. And it wasn't that Yogananda couldn't love that tiger into taming him, but merely because Yogananda could do it doesn't mean that it was the right response for everyone, or that it was a practical response for everyone. That's what you really have to think about. So I'll put it, here's the answer, it's a very simple one. Ananda has two principles that we always talk about. Wherever there is Dharma, there is victory, and people are more important than things. But there's actually a third one that isn't talked about as often, but ought to be. And this is something Master said to Swami. You have to be practical in your idealism. So the idea is that you can love darkness into light, but you have to also be practical as to whether you have the power to love darkness into light, or whether other strategies may also have to be used. Now, it's a very long and complicated discussion, and I suspect that the person who asked this question is not going to be satisfied with that answer, but at least it'll give us some food for thought. So, God bless you, and see you in next session.